Hey parents and caregivers, are you ready to get back into the paid workforce? If so, this workshop is for you. While the COVID-19 pandemic has reshaped the workforce in many ways since early 2020, data shows that parents and caregivers have been disproportionately impacted. 1 in 5 working-age adults in the U.S. stopped working to step up as teachers and playmates to minimize the impact the pandemic has on future generations. That includes both men and women, and the tips that we cover today will certainly be applicable for men as well. But it wouldn't be right for us to neglect to mention that women, moms, have been the majority of those having to downshift or leave jobs, resulting in women's labor force participation dropping to the lowest it's been in over 3 decades. A recent Indeed survey showed that 75% of women who quit or downshifted during the pandemic plan to return to the workforce. So we hope that this workshop today helps you do just that. You'll learn how to understand the value you bring, communicate the purpose and impact of your role at home, and optimize your job search. I'm excited to introduce our speakers for today. Krista is a growth marketing consultant for early stage startups and co-founder of a project called Know Our Work, whose mission is to eliminate the stigma associated with a COVID-related gap on mothers' or parents' resumes. Prior to consulting, Krista held leadership positions for brands such as HBO, SoulCycle, Compass, and more. Sherry is a senior manager of product marketing at Indeed and also founder and co-chair of the Parents and Caregivers Inclusion Resource Group in the Americas. And that's me, Brandy Warwas. I'm on Indeed's Job Seeker Experience team, and we're responsible for creating helpful resources and events like this Jobcast for our users like you. Take it away, Krista.
All right. Before we dive into the content, I want to share a bit about me and why this topic is something I am so deeply passionate about. I am a mom of 2 children under the age of 10 years old. And in the spring of 2020, I shifted to consulting after nearly 20 years in the corporate workforce. And consulting has provided me the flexibility that my family has really needed this last year. But earlier this year, I started conversations about potentially returning to the corporate workforce. But what I realized during a few of these conversations is that a perceived gap in caregivers' resumes due to the pandemic could pose as a hurdle for the millions of people that are going to be returning to the workforce. But the fact is that caregivers, and in particular, I'll say mothers, have always worked a double shift. But the work that is required of us during the pandemic is a full-time on-demand job. And I believe the work that we have done and continue to do as caregivers should be treated with the respect that it deserves. So I co-founded a project called Know Our Work. And our mission is to eliminate the stigma associated with a perceived gap in people's resumes. We believe one step in making that a reality is empowering people like you with the tools that you need to create a meaningful story about this unique time. So whether you're a caregiver who left the workforce because you were laid off, or you simply needed to prioritize your family during this pandemic, my goal for today is twofold. The first is to encourage you to recognize the skills that you grow and nurture as parents are extremely valuable for employers. And the second is to help you approach conversations about this perceived gap in your resume with confidence. I want to start by talking about the impact COVID has had on hiring. The businesses that have thrived during COVID generally fall into 2 camps. There's 1 camp of businesses that got really lucky because during a pandemic, their product or service became essential. And then there's this other camp of businesses who pivoted their business and operating model in order to provide new value to consumers or businesses. And that value could be necessity, or it could be providing reprieve. But most of those businesses fell into that 2nd camp. And that includes businesses ranging from local shops to large retailers. But what that has meant is that this new bright light has been shined on the importance of hiring employees who can think creatively, be flexible, band together, and do whatever it takes for the businesses to succeed. These traits are no longer only required for entrepreneurs or startups. but all businesses. Prior to COVID, I worked in a marketing leadership role for a real estate technology company called Compass. And the CEO built this really fantastic culture. And the culture is a culture of an entrepreneurial character. And it was very much intentionally designed to energize employees to flex when it was needed. And I'll be honest, that was pretty constant. Bounce back with passion, move fast, obsess about opportunities. These are a few of the entrepreneurial principles that play a critical role in Compass's success. And I've observed with awe as my team members took on new roles that often they had little or no experience in, or it was not the role that they originally were hired for. And what I've realized throughout that role is that this is the future of business. In today's economy, businesses require professionals at all levels, across all industries, who can embrace change and welcome new opportunities. COVID has also provided this raw transparency into the fact that parents are better trained than most to rise when we need to. As someone who has held both a leadership role within an ever-changing professional environment and a mother supporting young children during COVID-19, the character required to succeed at both is exactly the same. As parents, we have led our family in navigating them through COVID-19, and this has required unwavering confidence, creative problem solving, compassion, flexibility, and these are the same traits you'll bring back into the workforce. So the opportunity you have is to present yourself as the leader that you are. And that starts with crafting a thoughtful story around the purpose and the impact of your role at home. Those who can tell a meaningful story regarding career breaks by leaning into parenthood and caregiving and doing it with pride, we believe will stand out and leave a long-lasting positive impression. The majority of hiring managers believe that when interviewing for a job, parents should discuss their career breaks and use the opportunity to highlight the value of the time and the relevant transferable skills that they gain during those breaks. A gap without explanation actually requires and raises more questions than the reason, than those when reason for the gap is clearly stated on your resume. At Know Our Work, we're encouraging people to put their role at home on their resume. And I can get that this can feel a little counterintuitive because more often than not, we've been encouraged to be timid when speaking about caregiving responsibilities at home. But if you can change the way you view the value of this time and can communicate that effectively, you can harness it as an opportunity to emphasize the skills that you've gained and grown as caregivers that are attractive to potential employers. Here's some example on this slide of language Know Our Work created to give to people like yourselves as a starting off point to shape your own meaningful story. First and foremost, we're encouraging anyone to add Know Our Work to their resume. And some of the descriptive language could look something like this: CFO, Chief Family Officer, master the art of embracing change and pivoting towards new opportunities, solve problems by creating engaging experiences that connect our children with curriculum, bounce back with passion to help families see a bright light that shines in spite of all that has been lost, led every day with unwavering confidence, compassion, and creativity. The idea for this actually came from my husband, who years ago took a career break when we relocated to New York and our daughter was 10 months old. He owned his parenthood completely on LinkedIn and resume. In fact, he had several recruiters compliment him. He used humor and witty copy and somehow managed to even incorporate diaper changing into this core description and somehow still managed to connect it with being an engineering leader. And I can promise you that it absolutely paid off. You can also strengthen your story by finding a project that's independent from your family. Even if all you can do is allocate 1 hour a week, and I know even 1 hour right now seems almost impossible to find, but if you can, I encourage you to volunteer, freelance, mentor, contribute to your community, or build something from scratch, even if building is unrelated to your profession. And it can really serve as two purposes. The first is to remind you of the pride that comes from a professional contribution. And it can arm you with an interesting story to share in that interview. My guess is it would definitely spark an interesting conversation during interviews and just make that conversation more memorable in the eyes of the people that are interviewing you. You can also look into returnships, which have been growing in its scale since the pandemic began. Businesses like Facebook and Walmart, Apple, Amazon, they created returnship programs prior to the pandemic for people who had had an extended break. These internships or returnships give participants several months of paid on-the-job training at companies who then have the option of hiring these returnees full-time. And so this could be a great way to take a step back from the workforce or even take the first step into the workforce, but it could also be a great opportunity to test out a career change. So if you research returnships online, I bet you'll find a ton of information and options. Let's talk about transferable skills. When applying for a role that requires a job change, it's really important that you communicate and emphasize your transferable skills on your resume. Transferable skills are qualities that carry over from one role to another because they're useful to the employers across various jobs and industries. And so while, you know, many soft skills are considered transferable, it's just important to be cognizant that there are also some hard skills that fall into this category. It could be things like technology literacy, writing experience, management experience, experience with customers or client service. So those transferable skills are important to highlight when you are really considering changing your career path. While I have always worked in marketing, I have managed to pitch myself on a number of occasions for roles that I'll admit I did not have all the required hard skills. But what I did was connect the dots for my employer so they could easily see how I could, in fact, apply some of the skills from my old job to a new role, even if that role required a steep learning curve. On that note, I do want to mention and emphasize this. Never underestimate the power of passion for learning and the excitement of being challenged in new ways. I promise you, it makes a huge difference when being considered for a role. All right, spot your strengths. So in addition to connecting dots for the potential employer, it's really important to understand what makes you unique. And to do that effectively, my advice is to reflect on your unique strengths. I strongly recommend looking outside of yourself to formulate this point of view because, be honest, like we have our view of ourselves, but it's really valuable to get those in your life where you've engaged with or worked with to get their perspective as well. And so some of the things that I've done over the years to better understand my strengths, I've outright asked my old bosses, what are my superpowers? And what would you tell a prospective employer about me? I've looked for trends in my feedback from my bosses or colleagues or my team. And I've really like pulled those out and made sure I have those ready to go when I'm gonna be asked that question, most likely in an interview. I've developed also my own point of view about what is the type of employee and leader that I want to be. And I encourage you essentially to do the same. We wanna talk about updating your entire resume. So when you update your resume with caregiving, and as we talked about transferable skills, and of course your superpowers, you also want to be sure to give a critical eye to all of your professional experience. What could you do to update your previous roles that would strengthen your skills for the role that you're applying for? So some of the questions I often ask myself is like, how would I adapt that introductory summary about myself to maybe more closely align with the role that I'm applying for? Or are there any keywords that I could add to older roles that would convey a consistency in who I am and what I offer and the types of challenges that I've tackled?
All right, Krista, thank you so much for this amazing overview so far. I hope those of you listening have gotten a lot of takeaways about the strengths that you bring. And our hope is in this next section that we can show you a little bit of what Indeed can do to help you along that path with the products and tools that we offer. Before I jump in a little bit to resumes, I wanted to share a little bit of background about me. So as Brandy mentioned, I am a senior manager of product marketing at Indeed. I am also a mom to a 4-year-old daughter, and I am the founder of the Parents and Caregivers Inclusion Resource Group at Indeed. Externally, these groups are known as employee resource groups, and we are here to advocate on the behalf of parents to improve our workforce and make sure they're represented and their needs are heard. We also bring community to one another and ensure that we feel seen and supported and surrounded with care and empathy during this time. Last year was really challenging for us as my husband lost his job at the beginning of the pandemic and became our full-time stay-at-home father for my daughter and homeschooled her. And I was the breadwinner. So things have shifted a lot since then, but I've definitely seen the strengths I bring working 2 jobs. And I'm really thankful that we're having this conversation today for those of you who are currently doing the hard work of caregiving and also want to get paid for the work that you do. All right, so let's jump in. Krista just talked about updating your entire resume and some tips to do that. If it feels daunting or overwhelming, visit resume-review.indeed.com and we are here to help you take your resume to the next level. We offer free templates you can use with your Indeed resume. When you upload your resume to your profile, you get to choose different templates to work from. We also offer a free resume report where on demand, as you upload your current resume, our system can tell you ways to improve that resume, the structure, the context, so that it's a little bit more optimized. You can also choose to pay a small fee for an expert to review your resume and make suggestions, or even completely rewrite it and rehaul it for you. So Brandy will be posting links to that in the chat. Next, an important thing I want to make y'all aware of is that it's a great way to brand yourself to employers, but you can actually prove to them that you have the skills to do the job that they're looking for. On Indeed, we have over 130 skills assessments that measure both IQ and EQ, emotional intelligence. These are short tests created by psychologists and experts that measure various job-related topics from business math to customer service. It can help you show that you have the skills a job requires in a way that maybe a traditional resume, your work history, or your educational background may not, especially if you're trying to change fields, as Krista mentioned earlier. You can access Indeed assessments at my.indeed.com after you upload your resume that is newly revamped and completed. You will see an option at the bottom of your profile page to search for assessments, and you have the option to share those results and attach them to your Indeed profile. You can also hide these results at any time, but you can't retake the assessment. So when you sit down to take it, it'll give you an estimate of how long it takes. Make sure you're ready and have done some preparation beforehand. Also, a note that some employers, as they post jobs, may require a specific assessment in order to apply for a role. But if you've already completed it, then you have a leg up. Next, in addition to creating an awesome resume and showcasing your skills through assessments, we also want to help you prepare for the interview. I promise interviews will run a lot more smoothly if you invest the time in advance to shape your story and anticipate the questions that you may be asked. First and foremost, I want to encourage you to speak confidently about the time you spent leading your family through a pandemic and prepare a meaningful story that illustrates that. You don't need to justify or apologize for the professional sacrifices you've made for your family. These sacrifices are a signal of your character, and you have every right to be proud of it. What you can do ahead of the interview is reflect on what you've learned about yourself during this time, and maybe identify 3 insights you've gained about yourself, which make you better prepared to tackle this new role you're interested in. What you are doing is demonstrating self-awareness and the ability to learn from challenging situations. I'm also big on selecting 3 to 5 points that you absolutely want to communicate about yourself during an interview, and then doing what you can to ensure you have that opportunity to highlight these things. It could be something about your character, such as your strengths, and it could be a project that you've worked on, or a way that you've positively impacted a company culture or even your community. Have those in your back pocket to pull from during the interview. Also consider what you'll need from a potential employer. I think oftentimes we forget when we're sitting across the table or the virtual screen in that chair, you're interviewing the company too. And so you'll want to ask the interviewer things about schedule flexibility, working from home, sick day coverage, paid time off, parental leave, et cetera. And I know that these can be daunting, but this is a nationwide conversation that's been happening if you've been paying attention to the news and politics. So we do recognize the lack of policies in place, but that employers are also seeing that and know that it's important to offer as well. Lastly, plan for childcare or set expectations as needed. Over the last year, I know at least for us at Indeed, we have started to normalize work-life integration, which means kids, pets, family members will pop up into a video window if you're working from home. I recommend leveraging your trusted circle for childcare, or let the interviewer know that you may have a child doing remote learning at home with you. These things come up. They may or may not be in the same situation. If you are interviewing in person, companies like KinderCare have also sponsored a day of childcare drop-in for those who are interviewing. So check with your local providers as well.
I just want to jump in and add one insight on this conversation about telling your story in the interview. I've been really lucky. I've actually hired dozens of employees over the course of my career, and I've managed teams from like 2 to 15 people. And yes, I do look for transferable hard skills, right? So in my world is going to be like, do they have paid experience? Do they have social media experience, et cetera? But I've chosen candidates with less hard skills and more passion, drive, determination, and demonstrates a willingness to learn over someone who just ticks the boxes on hard skills. Hard skills can be learned, but character traits define who we are and how we tackle challenges as they arise. And I know I am not the only hiring manager who has the same philosophy. Let's talk about building your personal brand. And we really have been talking about it almost throughout this entire conversation, right? Because we've talked about your resume. We've talked about, you know, your LinkedIn. We've talked about interviewing. But how you present yourself holistically can influence your ability to land a job. And there's a couple of core principles that I just like live and die by when it comes to my personal brand that I want to share with you. The first is be focused. You need to accept that you can't be everything to everyone. So prioritize what attributes you want to communicate about who you are. My personal branding is I love growth marketing. I have experience in growth marketing. It is what I want to do and continue to do in my career. I'm a big supporter of mothers and parents. I care deeply about a positive work environment, and I am fascinated by startups. So that's my personal brand, and that's what I communicate consistently across like any engagement with me professionally. The second is be consistent. So once you've got your swim lane, you want to communicate and reinforce those principles at every touch point and do it over, over, and over again. Super important in order for it to stick. The third is be genuine. You know, don't try to be someone you're not, because if you aren't, it will absolutely shine through. Knowing who you are, what you're passionate about, and explaining why it is valuable to a potential employer has to come up from a place of authenticity, or unfortunately, they will likely not believe you. The last one is be positive. Keeping a positive attitude and helping and this showing this side of helping others will only help grow your brand. Businesses are attracted to employees who they believe can really positively impact their work culture, and in turn will then motivate others around them to bring their own positive attitude. And ultimately, this all helps improve productivity, right? Enthusiasm and positivity is infectious. And you know, you want to be and demonstrate yourself as a force for good.
Before we jump into this next section, we'll pause and take one of the questions that's come in, particularly relevant for the resume conversation. Should caregiver be added as a line for 2020 on a chronological resume without an employer?
So yes, absolutely. So if you want, you are more than welcome. And luckily, there's a number of projects that kind of have popped up over the last several months, because this need is so apparent. you know, with the pandemic and the number of people that are not working or not returning to work right now in order to care for others. And that is to, yes, add caregiving. We are encouraging at Know Our Work. We're adding people to add Know Our Work as the company on your resume. And we've had people on LinkedIn on their resume say that they're adding Know Our Work. They're saying their position is, you know, as we sort of said, like chief, CFO, or you could say general manager. Like, I think there's an opportunity to play with this and make it feel like your own. But at knowourwork.com, which you'll have this in like the last slide, and you'll have this deck, I'm sure, is that we have that initial like springboard of ideas as to like how to describe, you know, yourself in that job description. But you got to put caregiving on in some way, shape, or form, because, you know, having the gap, if you don't explain it, it's just going to raise more questions. I noticed this came up, and sorry, Brandy, if I'm stealing your thunder on another question, came up about someone who had a family member who was ill. And, you know, if you guys go to my LinkedIn, and you will, you know, you'll have it at the end of this presentation. There is another gap in my resume. And that was a period of time that I decided to use a quote, but it was a time I was taking care of my father, who was really not well, and really 4 or 5 months of just needing a lot more care. And I didn't put that on my resume for a long time. And then I found people kept asking me about it, and someone gave me the advice to add it. And you'll see how I did it. And again, you have to find what's right for you, but I found a quote that was about the importance of caring for those, you know, who are not well. And I just sort of leave it at that. And anyone, you know, I don't need to explain who it was or why or what exactly my details were, but I am completely outlining that there was something I was doing really important during this time. And it was giving enough information that they can be like, okay, you know, and sort of leave it at that. You don't need to share every detail, but I think that there's some signal of words and language you can use that should just eliminate that question or doubt among an employer.
Yeah, and I can jump in to echo everything Krista said. You know, with Know Our, put caregiver, put parent on your resume with Know Our Work as the company or without, but claim it and own it, because it is definitely a value. And I want to address the question in the chat about, I've always been told not to put my parental status or caregiving status. In fact, we have seen studies that show in the past bias against this. But I would say if you Google women in the workforce and COVID, and you see all of the articles that Time and Fortune, all of the media is covering, we know that we have to move to a new place in order for our economy to recover and thrive. And that means we need parents, we need caregivers in the workforce. You know, if a company is to meet their bottom line, you can't do it without people. And if people can't show up to work because they don't have caregiving resources and the right policies to support them, our economy won't recover. So it's a cycle, and you are at the center of that cycle and connecting it all. So own it. Tell people I am here to contribute to the bottom line, and we're here to support you with that. And I would say, if you do receive bias or pushback from talking about your status, I guess I would take the stance to say, now you know where their values lie. Right. And so as you're sitting in this interviewee chair, remember, you're the interviewer too. Find a place that supports you as you are. You deserve that.
Thanks, Sherry. And thanks, Krista.
Okay. Let's talk about optimizing your job search. Job searching, I know it can be overwhelming. You know, within each industry and specialization, there is such a wide variety of roles. And now, even more so than ever, I feel like job titles seem to be, you know, there's no kind of like clear blueprint anymore in the way that I feel like there was maybe a little bit more so 10 years ago. And then, of course, there's also different kinds of company cultures. So how do you prioritize your time to ensure that you're investing, you know, your energy into the roles that match your skill and your passion? I was given this writing exercise years ago by a colleague that I deeply respect, who was coaching me as I explored what I wanted to do next. And what he advised is I write down what my ideal day looks like, starting with walking out my front door. And the idea is that it's creating a mental image of the work life that you want to lead, so that as you read job descriptions, evaluate roles, and figuring out what's right for you, you kind of are creating this North Star to help guide you along the way. And so I've done this now several times over the course of my career. And some of those details that he provided me, I'll now share with you. So as you're creating this, you know, day in the life, you know, are you walking? Are you taking public transportation? Are you driving? How are you getting to work? Or are you working from home? Or is it a space, you know, is the space that any office outside of your home, is it an open plan? Is it an office with offices? You know, what are you doing with your day? Are you working alone? Are you working with other people? You know, what are the skills that you're exercising? Is it talking, writing, presenting, coding? What are you learning and how do you want to grow? What is your interaction like with your colleagues? Is it a really social place? Is it a collaborative place? Is it, you know, what does that look like? What is the culture like that you feel like you would really thrive in? And I love this one is, how would you describe your job to your friends and family? Because that's always like the true kind of truth, right? Of what is it that you love and maybe you dislike about your job? And no job is perfect, but I think starting to understand what it is you want, what are the must-haves, and what are the things that you can live with that you would be looking for in your next role? Because I believe that if we want to create the life that we want, we can do that by painting the picture of what that looks like. And again, that becomes your North Star and your tool for prioritizing one job application over another. And, you know, finding a job is a job in itself. And there's good days and bad days. But what really makes a difference is having a regular schedule and like a commitment to yourself to sort of make that happen. And you can develop, you know, momentum by creating this regular schedule and setting goals for yourself. And some of these goals could be, you know, editing your resume, looking for job postings, networking, we're going to talk about in a minute. And, you know, following up with past job applications. It can also be helpful to set like a daily application goal, or even also rewarding yourself in small but meaningful ways when you hit these goals. This, of course, can be challenging as a caregiver. Like creating a schedule to job hunt is, you know, almost feels at times like laughable because, you know, we're constantly juggling other people's needs and rarely have time for our own. But what I've done in the past is during the day, I will scan and save possible roles or save articles that I want to read later. And then I use post-bedtime to review and potentially draft an outreach, an email or a cover letter for a role in the evening time. But I don't send it because I know I am not my best at 9 p.m., so I save it, and then in the morning, maybe while kids are eating breakfast or something, I read through my outreach. Often I'm making edits, and then I press send. Let's talk about networking and calling on your contacts. Reaching out to your network can truly be a game changer when it comes to finding a job. And it's important you reach out for the help when you need it. Don't hesitate in asking for an introduction or advice from a category expert, or simply words of encouragement before walking into an interview. That could be someone you know or someone you don't know. Asking for help, I know it can be harder for some more than others. And that may be even more exacerbated after we've all felt so isolated for so long. And I think that we can often forget what it's like to lean on others. But I promise you, often all we have to do is raise our hand. I've used my network to achieve a variety of goals over the course of my career, and certainly when it's come to like considering my next job. And, you know, I've done it to explore what type of company I want to work for, or just talk out loud about the type of role I'm considering. I've often sought advice regarding a specific role, or even more so like somebody that works at the company that I'm applying, you know, I want to apply for a role for. Because the fact also is that, number one, you get an inside scoop, like what is it actually like to work at these companies and how is it structured internally? But the other big game changer is that like referrals can make a huge difference when it comes to being considered for a role. And that is responsible. Referral programs are responsible for around half of new hires in the majority of companies. Also, going into a job interview with a recommendation from a trusted professional in your field can help increase your chances of being seen in a positive light. And, you know, it's just definitely despite, you know, employee gaps, right? Employment gaps. The other one I do, I've talked to some of my colleagues in the past that are running mock interviews, and just so that I feel really prepared for the types of questions that I anticipate I'm going to be asked. But I also really try to stay in touch with my network, even when I'm not job hunting. And I simply reach out saying, I would just love to hear what you're up to these days. And I've been so surprised how many times those conversations have inspired me in one way, shape or form, or also informed me in my sort of own personal decision-making when it came to looking for jobs. But you should be mindful of always doing your best to carve out the time to be building your professional network. And part of that is also helping others when they are raising their hand and asking for support. You know, as part of your job hunt, you know, you should include networking as part of your goal setting. You know, I have a friend who wants to change careers, and she's setting a goal of at least 2 virtual meetings or coffees a week with professionals, because it is sometimes just getting out there and talking to people can really build your confidence. It can may set you up. You never know who they're going to know, who they're going to offer to connect you with. And so I really encourage you to, again, like raise your hand and network. There is a job cast that's entirely dedicated to networking, and Brandy's going to add it to the chat. So check it out if you need some help with this.
All right. So I'll jump in again to offer some resources on Indeed that can help you get started in your job search. So I'm really happy and excited to let you know that over the past few months, the past year, we have a newly formed product segment team focused on helping caregivers return to work. One of our recent wins was to make mom-friendly a search term on Indeed.com, which yields jobs that promote paid time off, parental leave policies, flexible schedules, work from home, dependent health insurance, adoption assistance, and more. If you look at the screen, you simply search mom-friendly into the what bar and your location or remote into the where bar, and you will get jobs that meet those criteria I mentioned. And then the next thing we want to do is research the company before you apply for jobs in order to find the right culture for you. Indeed has a section of our site called Company Pages, where you can find information about an employer through reviews from current and former employees. Here I have a screenshot of the Indeed company page, where under the benefits tab, you can see that we offer paid parental leave, paid time off, childcare reimbursement, et cetera. Even if you're done having kids or you are a caregiver, not for a child, you may find that a company with a good parental leave policy indicates that there are more parents and caregivers in the company's workforce, and there may be more general support for working parents. You can also look for employee resource groups, as I mentioned, which provide community and advocate on your behalf. You can learn about Indeed's commitment to diversity, inclusion, and belonging in the Why Join Us tab and learn about the 10 ERGs that we have at Indeed. And then lastly, as Krista mentioned, we know you are working the double, the triple, the quadruple shift right now. And so there's no need to work harder. Let's work smarter. So automate your search. Once you have found the right keywords and search terms that are right for you, you can automate the search using job alerts. Job alerts are email updates about new jobs that fit the criteria that you've set. So it's a convenient way to see new postings as soon as somebody posts a job that has the key title that you're looking for in the location you want. You can create multiple job alerts to send to you either daily or get a digest weekly. To activate your job alerts, go to the top right of your search results page, enter your email, and click activate. And to set up job alerts on the mobile phone, scroll to the bottom of the search results page, enter your email, and click activate. Be sure to figure out the best search queries to get the types of job you want before you set an alert. That way, the email updates are more likely to contain new jobs that are actually a fit for you. If you find that your job alert is too broad or is not yielding the right results, you'll likely get too many emails you don't want, and you should modify the search terms and reset a new alert. You can pause, delete, and manage the frequency in your account at subscriptions.indeed.com at any time. And lastly, I want to say for all of you who've joined today, thank you for listening thus far. We're about to wrap up. But I recognize the work that you do in caring for others is real work. Caregiving is a job that deserves recognition. It deserves value. It deserves commensurate pay. It deserves protection. And as the only developed country in the world without a paid family leave policy and without universal preschool, as a country and as a community, we really need to do better. If the pandemic has taught us anything, it's the value of caregiving and its pivotal role in keeping our society thriving and moving forward. And so supporting parents and caregivers will be critical to rebuilding our economy, as I mentioned. I mean, if all of us were getting paid for the multiple shifts we work, we could increase the GDP by trillions. So know that you are worthy. And thank you for holding down the multiple jobs and showing up each day for your family and your community. We see you. Now let's get you paid.
All right. So let's recap everything that we've covered today. Look, first and foremost, employers need the skills that you develop as a parent. Highlight those experiences and transferable skills on your resume. Shape your story with work experience and personal branding, and leverage your network and Indeed's resources to optimize your job search for the best opportunities. As I said at the beginning of this job cast, you have the opportunity to present yourself as the leader that you are. And we hope that today's session has been helpful in achieving that goal.
Thank you, Krista and Sherry. Now let's get to some more questions. So first question, this seems to be focused just on the last year with COVID, but what if you've been a caregiver for multiple years? And what if that gap has been closer to 10 years of caregiving? How would I get back into the workforce?
Great question. I completely understand it. I can imagine it would feel overwhelming to sort of figure out how to take those first steps. I do think a lot of the tools and tips that we have highlighted today are very relevant to your situation. You know, I think that, like, look, it's very much about continuing to own your caregiving. I go back to that comment I made, I think halfway through the deck, this idea of finding independent work outside of your caregiving at home and your responsibilities at home, that's something that is completely, you know, ownable to you. And as I said, I think it's like two things. Number one, it's helping to build that confidence, but it's also helping to have a story, an interesting and meaningful story to tell. And ideally, that story has some way connects with the types of roles that you want to go for. So as an example, we talked about volunteering and freelancing. We talked about mentoring. We talked about contributing to your community. You know, you can think, what is the type of roles that I could do in the immediate term when it comes to, if you're looking for project management work, if you're looking for marketing work, how can you raise your hand in your own community or through volunteer work to be able to start to exercise some of those skills so that you can bring that into the conversation, you can put it on your resume as you are going for those jobs. I'd also say, you know, look at returnships and internship programs. I know it's like a short term, you know, sort of like a first step to getting you to the role that you want. But I do think that those types of internships and returnships can make a really big impact in helping people transition to the full-time role that you really want. Sometimes we have to take these like stepping stones to get to our North Star. And it's just sort of accepting that and finding ways to be excited about that in sort of the immediate term. And then the other part is like network, you know, it's using your own network. I certainly have had a number of people in my life who've taken extended gaps, but have had success in returning to the workforce because of the relationships that they created. And those people knew them personally, knew what kind of character and traits that they exhibited, and then was an advocate for them in going for those roles. And so those are some of my initial thoughts about, you know, those individuals. I saw someone has maybe 10 years experience. But the other is, you know, the skills that you learned 10 years ago when you were, you know, before caregiving, they are still relevant today. It's not like you forgot them, you know? And so there's ways that you can go and think about how could I maybe start to stimulate those parts of myself or remember those parts of myself. And the other one is like education, or even I know there's a number of platforms out there right now that are offering free workshops or free classes. There's so much content online that you can use to even just refresh yourself. If it's in project management, what is the latest conversations happening around project management? What are the tools that businesses are using today? What is the language? How are they talking about the challenges that these businesses are finding when it comes to, let's say, project management? And that would be the same across any kind of industry or role. Just so when you walk into those conversations or you're writing your resume, you're making sure that the language that you're using truly is reflective of what is these businesses are facing themselves in today's current climate.
And I'd like to add, in addition to what Krista said, I'm super excited to announce, and we announced this a couple of weeks ago, that Indeed and Luminary have created our Indeed Luminary Fellowship, in which we'll provide 150 participants with access to ongoing education, incremental support for job placement, coaching and mentoring, leadership training, content and community, professional networks, guidance, and exposure. And we are explicitly ensuring that half of the fellowships are offered to women of color. And so you can check that out through Luminary, and Brandy will send a link to that in the follow-up as well.
The next question is, I was a caregiver for my parents for over 4 years and now find it difficult to give references. How do I address the lack of references as recent employers are no longer in business and others I no longer have contact with?
Yeah, that's tricky. I mean, I know everybody needs references in this day and age. I guess on the, you know, when it comes to these businesses are no longer working, I still believe that the individuals, you know, within those businesses would still be great places to start for references, even if they don't work for that business anymore. And that could be, you know, anyone from certainly your boss, but a colleague or a peer, someone that maybe reported to you, someone that worked in the people team, anyone who can just speak to your character, because that's more likely what the types of questions that they would be asking of this individual from a role that you had, you know, four years ago. I also would think about like, what are other groups or individuals, organizations that you interact with in your life that can speak to your character? You know, who, if you've been taking care of your family for the last 4 years, I mean, I certainly know when I was helping take care of my dad, you know, there were so many people that I was phoning and trying to reach out for support and help, and became kind of my village, right? And so those people who have kind of been a part of that journey with you, could potentially also be another resource to speak on your behalf around the type of character and commitment that you have to the jobs that you have taken on. And that job that you've taken on as a caregiver for your parents is exactly the same. So that would be my two cents.
So I think we have time for one more question. Can you recommend any ways to connect with other people in the same situation that have been out of the workforce for a long period of time due to caregiving? It can feel isolating to take part in groups with other job seekers who have more recent experience.
Goodness, specific groups for that. I don't know. I can't say I have like a specific group. I have my like go-to groups on Facebook in particular. You know, I'm in the camp. Most recently, I'm more focused on parents groups than like caregivers for, you know, elderly like my father. But I've never been shy to sort of raise my hand in those groups and like, look, this is me. It's a little bit about me. I'm looking to connect with other people and just have an open discussion around the different ways to tackle returning to work. And I'd love to hear from other individuals around, you know, maybe what success or what they've learned works or doesn't work as they've gone through that process. If you are someone or know someone in a similar situation, I would really appreciate if you would provide my contact details. But so within that, I've like, you know, there's certain moms groups within like locally. There's like national Facebook groups that I have joined. I do tend to like reach out to the moms because I feel like we're in a similar situation. So I think it's really on a case-by-case basis. Like what is, you know, who are other people that would most likely be the most closely related to your situation that you can really connect with on a meaningful way.
Yeah, and I'll add some really great ones people are submitting in the chat. So Nicholas suggested the Mom Project. I love them. They're doing great work. Check them out. Also, Linda suggested Caregivers Corner on Facebook. I haven't heard of that. Thank you, Linda. Caroline suggested for relaunchers, APRES, APRES, I hope I pronounced that right, and I Relaunch, one word. That's also great. Meetup.com also has groups for specific niches, so you can probably find something there. So there's a lot that exists. If you start to Google returnships, women back to work, caregivers back to work, I'm sure you'll find a lot more resources through Google too.
Thanks. I think that's all of the time we have for today, but if you found this to be helpful, check out our other jobcasts at indeed.com/jobcast and be sure to follow Indeed on social media.
I just want to make sure you have my contact details. This is my email address. Check out my LinkedIn. I mean, there's always room to improve my LinkedIn, anyone's LinkedIn. But I feel pretty good about how I've sort of presented my gaps. And then please visit knowourwork.com. There's more information and more content on there. Probably echoes a number of the pieces that we discussed today.
Have a question? Leave it as a video comment for the Indeed team. And don't forget to like and subscribe for more career advice. Thanks for watching.